Hello everyone, I'm Swati Sharma, taking Indian Economy. So first topic, or you can say that the introduction of Indian Economy, today's topic of discussion. So a general meaning of Indian Economy, basically it is termed as the developing economy of the world. Indian Economy is a developing economy, and there are a few features like there is a low per capita income, agriculture-based economy, and we'll discuss in detail the features of Indian economy. So, economy of India is characterized as developing market economy. It is the world's fifth largest economy of nominal GDP and third largest by purchasing power parity, triple P. So, what is triple P basically mean? Purchasing power parity is an economic theory that allows the comparison of the purchasing power of various world currencies to one another. It is a theoretical exchange rate that allows you to buy the same amount of goods and services in every country. This is called triple P. So we are in the third position if we talk about triple P. So according to IMF, International Monetary Fund, on a per capita income basis, India ranked 139th of GDP and 118th of GDP in triple P terms in 2018. Since the start of 21st century, annual average GDP growth has been 6% to 7%. And from 2014 to 18, India was the world's fastest growing major economy, surpassing China. So historically, India was the largest economy in the world for most of the two millennia from the first until 19th century. Now, features of Indian economy. There are very interesting fact about Indian economy, and there are a few features of Indian economy which we will discuss one by one. So first feature is low per capita income. If we talk about India, the national income and per capita income is very low, and it is considered as one of the basic feature of underdevelopment. So as per World Bank estimates, the per capita income of India stood at only $720 in 2005. Keeping aside a very few countries, this per capita income figure of India is the lowest in the world, and it is even lower than China and Pakistan. So this is lower per capita income. So in 2005, if we talk about 2005 numbers, the per capita income figure in Switzerland was nearly 76 times, and in US it is 61 times. In Germany, it is 48 times. So rest all other countries like Japan in 54 about times the per capita income figure in India. Thus, the standard of living of Indian people remained all along very low in comparison to that of developed countries of the world. This disparity in the per capita income of India and other developed countries has registered a manifold increase during the last four decades. Even after making necessary adjustment, the per capita income differences, although narrowed down, yet remain quite significant and huge. So we see the numbers. So it is very significant and huge. In order to convert national currency figures to the US dollar, the utilization of official exchange rates does not allow to measure the relative domestic purchasing power of currencies. So this is what you called low per capita income. Then excessive dependence of agriculture and primary producing. Everyone knows that Indian economy has like excessive dependent on agriculture. So it is characterized by too much dependence on agriculture, and thus it is primary producing. Out of the total working population of our country, a very high proportion of it is engaged in agriculture and allied activities, which contributed a large share in the national income of our country. So if we talk about in 2004-05, nearly 58% of the total working population of our country was engaged in agriculture. And now obviously it is reduced, not that much if we talk about in 2004, it is reduced very much, but still the number is very high. In most of the countries like Asia, Middle East, Africa, and from two-thirds to four-fifths of their population are solely dependent on agriculture. So in most of the developed countries like UK, US and Japan, the percentage of active population engaged in agriculture ranges between 1 to 5% only. So this is one of the major feature of Indian economy. Then high rate of population growth. So we can't deny that we have very high rate of population. So India is maintaining a very high rate of population since 1950. So thus the pressure of population in our country is very heavy. This was resulted from a very high level of birth rates coupled with a falling level of death rate prevailing in our country. So in India, the rate of growth of population has been gradually increasing. Earlier it was like 1.3%, then 2.5%. But if we talk about in 2001 to 2011, it is 1.77%. The prime cause behind this rapid growth of population is the steep fall in its death. It is rate from like 49 per thousand during 1911 to 2000 to 7.1% per thousand in 2011. So on the other hand, if we compare its death rate, the birth rate of our population has gradually declined from 49 per thousand during 1120 to 21.8 per thousand in 2011. So thus, whatever development that has been achieved in the country, it is being swallowed up by the increased population. Moreover, this high rate of growth of population necessitates a higher rate of economic growth just for maintaining the same standard of living, right? So this imposes a greater economic burden on the economy of our country. As to maintain such a rapidly growing population, we require food, clothing, housing, schooling, health facilities, etc. in greater magnitude. Besides, this fast rate of growth of population is also responsible for rapid increase in the labor force in our country. So this is a high rate of population growth. Then next point is existence of chronic unemployment and underemployment. Rapid growth of population coupled with inadequate growth of secondary and tertiary occupations, which are responsible for the occurrence of chronic unemployment and underemployment in our country. In India, unemployment is structural one, unlike in developed countries, obviously, which is of cyclic type. So here, unemployment in India is the result of deficiency of capital. Indian industries are not getting adequate amount of capital for its necessary expansion so as to absorb the entire surplus labor force into it. Moreover, large number of labor force is engaged in the agriculture sector of the Indian economy than what is really needed. This has produced the marginal product of agricultural labor either to a negligible amount or to zero or even to a negative amount. So there exists disguised employment in Indian agriculture sector, which has resulted from too much dependence of population on land and absence of alternative occupation in rural area. So this is a major feature of Indian economy. Then poor rate of capital formation. So capital deficiency is one of the characteristic feature of Indian economy. Both the amount of capital available per head and the present rate of capital formation in India is very, very low. Consumption of crude steel and energy are the two important indicators of low capital per head in the underdeveloped countries, like in India, obviously. If we talk about in 1987, the per capita consumption of steel in India was only 20 kg as against 582 kg for Japan and 417 kg for USA. Similarly, the per capita consumption of electricity in 2003 was only 594 for India as against 14,057 for US and similarly 8,200 something for Japan. So moreover, this low level of capital formation in India is also due to weakness of the inducement of investment and also due to low propensity and capacity to save. So as per like Colin estimate, in order to maintain the same standard of living, India requires at least at least 14% level of gross capital formation. So this is a poor rate of capital formation. Then inequality in the distribution of wealth. Another important characteristic or feature of Indian economy is the maldistribution of wealth. The report of RBI reveals that nearly 20% of household owing less than 1,000 worth of assets possesses only 0.7% of the total asset in country. So moreover, like 51% of households owing less than rupees 55,000 worth of assets possessed barely 8% of the total assets. So lastly, the top 4% household possessing assets worth more than 50,000 held more than 31% of the total assets. It is a maldistribution in income. It is a result of inequality in the distribution of assets in rural area. On the other hand, if we talk about the industrial front, there occurs a high degree of concentration of assets in the hands of very few big business houses. So this shows like high degree of assets concentration in the hands of very few powerful business houses of our country. So this is very major factor of our Indian economy. Then low level of technology. Unlike Japan and all other developed countries, again, I'm saying this that we are not up to that level in terms of technology. So prevalence of low level of technology is one of the important characteristics of an underdeveloped economy like India. The economy of our country is thus suffering from technological backwardness. Obsolete techniques of production are largely being applied in both the agriculture and industrial sector of our country. So it's like sophisticated modern technology is being applied in productive units at a very limited scale, as it is very much expensive. So moreover, it is very much difficult to adopt modern technology in Indian productive system, which it's untrained, illiterate, and unskilled labor. Thus, due to the application of poor technology and lower skills, the productivity in both the agricultural and the industrial sector of our country is very low. So this has resulted in inefficient and insufficient production, leading towards obviously general poverty in our economy. So this is what low level of technology. Then underutilization of natural resources. We are fortunate that we are fully equipped with natural resources, but still we are not using it in a proper manner. We are underutilizing it, or maybe we are overutilizing it. We are not utilizing in the best possible manner to achieve the desired result. So in respect of natural endowments, India is considered to be a very rich country. As I said, various types of natural resources, was land, water, mineral, forest, power resources are available in sufficient quantity in various parts of our country. But due to its various inherent problems, like primitive techniques, shortage of capital, like inaccessible regions, small extent of the market, such huge resources remained largely underutilized. A huge quantity of mineral and forest resources of India still remains largely unexplored. Until recently, India was not in a position to develop even 5% of the total hydropower potential of our country. So we are not utilizing our resources. It is underutilized. Then lack of infrastructure. Lack of infrastructural facility is one of the serious problems from which the Indian economy has been suffering till today. These infrastructural facilities include transportation, communication facilities, electricity generation and distribution, banking and credit facilities, economic organization, health and educational institutions, etc. The two most vital sectors, that is agriculture and industry, could not make much headway in the absence of proper infrastructural facilities in the country. Moreover, due to the absence of proper infrastructural facilities, development potential of different region of the country largely remains underutilized. So this is a low level of lack of infrastructure. Then next point is a low level of living. the standard of living of Indian people, obviously it is not considered to be very good, right? It is considered to be very low. Nearly 25 to 40% of the population in India suffer from the malnutrition, right? So it is very pathetic situation for any country. The average protein content in Indian diet is about 49 grams only per day, in comparison to that of more than double the level in the developed countries of the world. So moreover, the low calorie intake in Indian diet is another characteristic of low level of living. In 1996, the daily average calorie intake of food in India was only 2,415 in comparison to that of 3,400 calories per day in various developed countries of the world. So the present calorie level in India is just above the minimum caloric level required for sustaining life, which is estimated at 2,100 calories. Moreover, a small percentage of Indian population have access to safe drinking water and proper housing facility. As per the estimate of National Building Organization, NBO, in total, there was a shortage of 31 million housing units at the end of March 1991. By the turn of the century, total backlog of housing shortage in the country is around 41 million units. So our country's situation is not good. Obviously, it's not acceptable, obviously, right? So we need to work upon it and we need to think towards it. Then next point is poor quality of human capital. Indian economy is suffering from its poor quality of human capital. Mass illiteracy is the root of this problem, and illiteracy at the same time is retarding the process of economic growth of our country. As per 2001 census, 65.3% of the total population of India is literate, and rest 34.7 something around percentage still remains illiterate. Unlike in the most developed countries like US, UK, Australia, illiteracy rate is even below than 3%, 2 or 3%. So moreover, the problem of illiteracy in India makes way for conservatism, and this is going against the economy of the country. So besides, low level of living is also responsible for poor health condition of general masses. So all these have resulted in the problem of poor quality of human capital in the country. Next is demographic characteristics. The demographic characteristics of India are not at all satisfactory. Rather, these are associated with high density of population. A smaller proportion of the population in working age group of 15 to 60 years and a comparatively larger proportion of population in the minor age group of 0 to 15 years. As per 2011 census, the density of population in India was 382 per square kilometer, as compared with world density of population of 41 per square kilometer. Even in China, the density is nearly 123% per square kilometer. So moreover, all these shows that basically the dependency burden of our population is very high. Moreover, lower income level, low level of living, including absence of balanced diet and proper housing and medical facilities, and are responsible for low life expectancy of 63.9 years in India in comparison to that of 75 in most of the developed countries. And it is high rate of infant mortality in India. That is about 53 per thousand children, as against only 5 to 7 per thousand in developed countries. So we need to think upon it, and we need to work on it. Then next point is inadequate development of economic organization. Like, poor economic organization is another important characteristic of the Indian economy. For attaining economic development at a satisfactory rate, certain institutions are very much essential. As for example, if we take for mobilization of savings and to meet other financial needs, more particularly in the rural areas, development of certain financial institutions are very much essential. In India, the development of financial institution is still inadequate in the rural areas. There is an urgent need to develop certain credit agencies for advancing loan to small farmers on easy terms, as well as to provide long-term and medium-term loan to industry. for protecting poor tenants from the clutches of landlords, proper enforcement of tenancy legislation is very much necessary. All these require maintenance of honest and efficient administrative machinery, which India is lacking very much. Thus, from the foregoing analysis, it has been revealed that the Indian economy largely remains underdeveloped, as the economy still exhibits the basic features of an underdeveloped economy. But considering its development strategies followed during past years, proper planning and progress attained in certain areas, Indian economy can safely consider to be a developing economy. And obviously, we can see that our government is doing a lot more to improve the situation of Indian economy. And obviously, they are working on to improve the GDP and the growth level of Indian economy. So this is all about this topic. Thank you.